Hello guys, Archangel here, and I want to talk a little bit about Knights of the Fallen Empire. Talk about the news that we have, the new futures that we know about, while giving my opinion on everything. So, for those of you that don't know, Knights of the Fallen Empire is the newest expansion for Star Wars The Old Republic, where our character, a veteran from the Great Galactic War, we will take the fight up to the Eternal Empire, that is this new threat to the galaxy. Now, if you are like me and has been following the last few content updates for Star Wars The Old Republic, with the whole Sith Emperor storyline, and was like me when I first saw this new expansion, where I was basically like, wait just a second, hold on, you can't just forget that storyline and jump onto a new one? We haven't dealt with the Sith Emperor yet, are you crazy? You can't just do that. Rest assured, without giving any spoilers, that one storyline leads directly into the other. They are both related. Just saying that because this one thing really bugged me for quite some time, okay? So, the expansion will also boost the max level to 65 and is free to all subscribers. Now, I remember when I first saw that, I was like, okay, so what's the catch here? I mean, you guys do want to make money somehow, right? Well, the catch is, BioWare is changing the way we are going to experience the story. Knights of the Fallen Empire on release date, that's October 20 for early access people and October 27 for the rest of us plebs, is going to have 9 chapters of story. Kind of a dumb name there, if I say so myself. And BioWare starting on early 2016, God knows what early means here, will start releasing the rest of the chapters one at a month. And how do you get access to these new chapters? You guessed it, you need to be subscribed at each month to unlock the chapter of that month. But let's say BioWare starts releasing chapters on January 2016, and you subscribe for the first time on Star Wars: The Old Republic in February, which means on the month that Chapter 11 would come out. You will still get all the chapters that were released before you subscribe. In other words, chapters 1 through 9 that were released on launch day and chapter 10 from the January month. This almost feels like a change in business model, even though it's still a free-to-play with an optional subscription model. One of the main reasons going forward which people will subscribe is to see the next part of the story, which is BioWare using its strengths to its advantage, which I think it's super smart. I wonder what would happen to this MMO if they had used similar business model from the get-go. Not only do I think it's very interesting, I think it's very fair. On paper, of course. I don't actually want to go play chapter 10 and freaking 3 minutes later. Well, chapter over, thanks for the subscription money, haha. On a final note about the storytelling, BioWare is making a point of saying whenever they can, we are going back to our roots with this one. They're saying that choices never had this much impact to the story. Now, if they are talking about all choices in dialogue, or just those binary light side, dark side, really easy to spot I am an actual choice that will have an impact choices, and actually how much of an impact these choices will have, we don't actually know, but I'm really excited to find out. So before I go any further, let me address some of the things that might interest new players before I bore them all out when I start talking about stat changes and shit, okay? So BioWare is going to start selling level 60 characters. Have to wonder where they took that idea from. So you can start right at the new content. Here's the thing though, and this is for both new and old players. The moment you start a new expansion, the moment you start Chapter 1, you can't go back to play any of Shadow of Raven, any of the Rise of the Hutt Cartel missions, and you can't do your class story either. Moving on to companions, probably the biggest change is that now every companion is able to change its role into a tank, healer or DPS. So if you play, let's say, with a Sith Juggernaut and you want a healer on the early levels when you're leveling, now you can set Vett to be your healer. Don't know how much I personally am going to use that though. Don't get me wrong, it's a freaking awesome change, it's a really good quality of life improvement little thing. But I don't know, I just feel like some characters have a specific role that fits them, and it's going to be really jarring to use the other ones. I'm looking at you, healer HK51. Anyway, another big change to companions is that gear is only going to affect their appearance now. Yeah? You heard me, you don't need to farm gear for your character, then go farm gear and mods for your companion anymore. The way a companion gets stronger is only by your level and the present stat. Not really much more to say about these two changes, they are just two solid quality of life improvements. On the subject of stat changes, there's a new stat now called Mastery, which basically is they move all the primary stats, aim, willpower, strength, and cunning, and they are all one stat now. The justification for this being, and I quote, "We want to make sure that when gear drops, if you want to use it, you can use it." End quote. I have to wonder if there is a little bit subtle implication here that all gears moving forward will be adaptive armor. Anyway, the other stat change is that both critical rating and surge rating have both converged into one single stat, and that's it for stats. About crafting, the max level for crew skills is still 500. Moving forward, you don't need anymore to go train to unlock the next tier of craftable items every what, like 70, 75 levels or something, so you don't need to keep doing that back and forth to the fleet and back again to where you were every time you unlock something new. Also, you don't craft any green items anymore. You start at blue quality and all armor that you craft is now adaptive. For those of you who don't know, adaptive armor is armor that adapts to whatever armor restriction your character has. All in all, it's a really cool addition, and I'm always all up for new options of customization. Gathering professions also work a little bit different. How good you are at gathering skill actually has an effect on how many materials you get. So if you're like level 500 scavenging and want to get some tier 1 metals, you are probably not going to need many of those for a while. You can even gather high level materials as a level 1 scavenger, but you're probably not going to get so much stuff. About commendations, the PvE comms are now called crystals. For what I can tell, it's just a name change. It still functions all the same. However, what did change is that we don't have anymore a weekly restriction as to how many crystals we can get. So, if you wanna farm the best crystal ever until the end of times, BioWare is basically saying, yeah, sure, great, you can do that, go for it, go ahead and knock yourself out. Another big change is to heroic missions. There's now a terminal on the fleet that you can access with a list of heroic missions. I presume the ones from the planets you either have been to, or the missions that you have a higher level than. It still isn't very clear. Anyway, the terminal gives you the mission with rewards all scaled up to your level. It also gives you an item which teleports you directly to where the mission is so you can go right at it. This just adds a new way to do leveling with your friends, and a new motive to revisit old planets, which I'm totally fine with. I can definitely see myself doing that with a friend between quests. Being like, hey, did you finish that quest yet? Okay, I finished mine, let's go to Dromunkas, do one or two heroic missions. A Sif must go back to its Sif of power every once in a while, you know? The other big change which ties in with the heroic mission is level sync, which should be instantly familiar for anyone who played Guild Wars 2. Players that go to planets below their level are going to have their level adjusted to a more reasonable one for that planet, so the enemies are still challenging. The enemies will also start giving you experience based on your level when they die. One particular little quality of life improvement that I really enjoy is Datacrons are now legacy bound, so you don't need to go running around collecting Datacrons with all your characters. Also, remember when I said that all primary stats are now called Mastery? Remember when you found that Datacron of Strength on your Sith Inquisitor and was mad because of how useless it was? Now that all stats, primary stats are being converted into Mastery, just saying. Going on a little Datacron hunt now might give you an edge when the expansion hits, just saying. So, that pretty much covers up the changes I'm more interested in, so I'll leave you with my general thoughts on the expansion as a whole. It's very clear to me that we are seeing a change of focus on this expansion. We got no new war zones, no new raids or dungeons. BioWare is scaling and balancing the old dungeons up, but we are not seeing anything actually new. Now, I personally felt like the story aspect of the old expansions was definitely lacking, especially of Rise of the Hutt Cartel. I mean, think about it for a second. Think about for example, Chapter 3 of the Imperial Agent story. Now think of Chapter 3 of the Sith Inquisitor story. And I'm sure there must have been some cool chapters on the Republic side, but you know, fuck pubs, okay? And then we got Chapter 4, Rise of the Hutt Cartel. It's not even a fair comparison, they are on another level entirely, and that's not even considering that the chapters from before are tailored to the characters' classes. Now when I speak to people about the Old Republic, or I see people talk about it on forums and say about what they enjoy and didn't enjoy about it when they played it, they always say things like, well, I really enjoyed the leveling, but I didn't enjoy much the high level content, or there wasn't any when I was playing. And I think this expansion is BioWare's answer to both those things, to players who haven't been satisfied with the story lately, and both to people who have stopped playing, but really enjoying the story content. And I think that's one of the objectives of this expansion, is to bring back those old people that really enjoy the story.
But of course, the trade-off here, the sacrifice, hard to dar, is that we got no new Control MMO content, we got no new war zones, nor flashpoints, nor operations like was saying before. And I mean, it's a trade-off, right? Even with the backing of EA and all the money that went behind this game, there are limits to what BioWare can do. And I feel like this expansion is BioWare's way of saying, look, if you guys want better story, we are going to need to have to focus a little bit more on it and leave the MMO content for later. This is a really crucial point for BioWare. It's on a really thin rope, because it needs to find this balance point. It needs to find this nice balance between story, between additional story and the MMO content, and the additional MMO content. And if he can find the balance, and if he can get new story, if he can get new war zones, new flashpoints, new operations, will be all good. I think if you can find the balance between it, a lot of people will really start enjoying this MMO, even people who never even played it before. And I mean, the reason I even thought Star Wars The Old Republic was going to be such a good MMO back in the day wasn't because it was a Star Wars game, even though I absolutely love the Star Wars franchise. It wasn't because it was in the Old Republic era, even though that's my favorite era of the franchise. And it wasn't even because it was a BioWare game, even though I have played every BioWare game since Star Wars KOTOR. It was because I thought of it this way. It's a never-ending BioWare game. A never-ending BioWare game. A game from BioWare where the story just keeps going. I remember when I played Mass Effect 1, and at the end of it I was like, damn, this Shepard guy is really tough. Jesus, he just doesn't die. And then I played Mass Effect 2, and I was like, Jesus Christ, man, this guy is a fucking machine. And then Mass Effect 3 come out, and I was like, dude, leave your legacy to your firstborn or something, Jesus. And like, that's what I wanted from Star Wars The Old Republic. What I wanted was the class story to end, the chapter 3 to end for my character, and later on, BioWare will just add new content to that story. So my character just got progressively more and more ridiculous. And I mean, what I got was Rise of the Red Cartel and Shadow of Realm, which was like kind of a good planetary mission, but wasn't really the class story. And I hope that this new expansion can scratch that particular itch, because it looks really good. And the cutscenes look really, really good. I just hope that every chapter can stand its two legs. I hope it's not very... the story isn't very segmented, or a chapter is basically like, well, you can jump this chapter, it doesn't happen really anything here. I hope that every chapter has its own worth, every chapter is really good, because from now on, basically, the quality of the chapters is what's going to determine a lot of subscriptions. So I hope it's really, really good. I really do. That worry aside, I can't wait to actually get my hands on this damn thing and be able to play through the story and be able to see all the different choices and consequences when I play more than one chapter. I'm really excited for it. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. Anyway, guys, I guess that's it. Those are my thoughts on Knights of the Fallen Empire. Thank you ever so much for listening, for watching. And if I may annoy you just a little bit more, if you really enjoy Star Wars, if you really enjoy The Old Republic era, I actually started a Let's Play of Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic on this very channel not too long ago. I played back in the day, I played like, almost a decade ago. So there are some things on the story that I still remember, some very specific moments that stick out, as I'm sure anyone who played the game can still relate. But I'm not giving any spoilers, it's very newcomer friendly, so if you're interested in the lore of the Old Republic, if you want to understand a little bit more of the things on the MMO, it would be lovely to have you there. Anyway, if you check it out, if you don't, have a great day, and hopefully, I'll see you guys next time. Bye bye, guys!